Well, what we've got is consolidated appeals in four cases, and we've set the argument time for 7.5, 7.5, 7.5. And because this is sufficiently complicated, what I propose to do is, even if we might take one of you over the 7.5, that won't take away from the argument time of the others of you for whom the 7.5 has been allocated. So don't be nervous if, for example, we take, I'm not sure, Ms. Parent over by 10 minutes, that's cutting into your time. That's not. So we'll, this is a complicated case with lots of issues, and we'll hear as much as I think we need to hear, rather than artificially restricting this to sort of 30 minutes total. So with that in mind, let's call Audubon Society of Portland versus, and all kinds of other people versus, oh my God, who's gonna be, it's gonna be Bernhard or Haaland at this point. So when you're ready, I think we've got, is it Ms. Fahey who goes first?
Yes, Your Honor. Good morning, and may it please the court. I'm Maura Fahey on behalf of Appellants Audubon et al. And I'd like to reserve 1 minute of my time for rebuttal.
Okay, now I think we were supposed to set this with 7 minutes and 30 seconds.
That's correct.
And this is Kathy. I'm with this remote timer, I'm not understanding the second thing.
So here's what we're going to do, Kathy, if you can manage it. And I'm not sure whether the technology is going to make this easy for you.
Yeah.
For each of the appellants, they've got 7 minutes and 30 seconds. And so when each one starts, just start them with 7:30 on the clock, even if we've gone over with the previous lawyer.
Okay. It's hard for me to figure out how to do the 0.30 on this remote one. So, okay.
Well, just do okay. 7.
Seven.
Okay, fine. So 7 minutes and 30 seconds is what it is.
Okay.
I'll just keep an eye on the clock and look for the 30-second mark.
Okay, we'll do the best we can. Sorry to interrupt. Let's start again. Take it from the top.
All right. Thank you. Good morning, and may it please the court. Maura Fahey for Appellants Audubon et al. And I'd like to reserve 1 minute of my time for rebuttal.
Okay.
This case involves the first ever comprehensive conservation plan on the Klamath Refuge Complex. Congress declared the major purpose of these refuges to be waterfowl management. But in recent years, the wetlands on these refuges have gone dry and disease outbreaks have killed thousands of birds. Meanwhile, commercial agricultural use has persisted. Because the plan adopted by the Fish and Wildlife Service maintains this status quo, it's arbitrary and contrary to law for at least three reasons. First, the plan violates the Refuge Act because it includes no actions to address the severe water shortages on Lower Klamath Refuge. Second, the record establishes that the present pattern of leasing is interfering with proper waterfowl management. And third, the agency refused to even consider a reduction in the agricultural leasing. The entire premise of a CCP is to guide refuge management towards achieving refuge purposes consistent with the provisions of the Refuge Act. And the agency's conclusion that this plan satisfies that charge is undercut by the fact that Lower Klamath wetland habitat will continue to go dry under this plan. The Refuge Act directs the service to assist in maintaining adequate water quantity and to acquire water rights that are needed for refuge purposes.
What do you make of the argument the government makes that the water issues are very complicated, but that some of them are out of their hands, that it's tied up in a wholly separate Oregon adjudication, that they are challenging, but that right now they have sort of limited control over this issue? What's your response on that point?
Yes, certainly, Your Honor, the water situation is complex, and Audubon fully acknowledges that the issues in the Klamath Basin generally are complicated. However, the agency did not justify its decision here based on that complexity. That is, they didn't find that there's no action that they can take to improve the situation on the refuge. And in fact, at Audubon's ER page 642, the agency explicitly acknowledged the availability of potential actions, transferring water rights outside of the refuge, that it noted that it was looking into, but then it failed to actually consider those actions as part of its plan and to include them in the management strategy. So it's clear on this record that justification provided by the government in its briefing is not actually the basis of the decision that they made here.
So what would happen if some of the land now used for agriculture were taken out of agricultural use? Would the water used for that agricultural use come to the refuge, or would it go to other higher priority users outside the refuge?
Yes, Your Honor. And that goes to the justification that the agency provided for not considering a reduction in leasing. But that is based on a false premise that the only option on the lease lands is irrigating for commercial agriculture. But the agency itself acknowledged on the record that it can in fact use its senior water right, its 1905 irrigation water right, to provide for temporary wetland habitat within the lease lands. And that's through the Walking Wetlands Program. However, they haven't implemented that program at all on Lower Klamath Refuge and really provide no explanation for that decision. And then on Tule Lake Refuge, they aspire to provide that, but concede that when there are drought periods, that action will not be carried out on the refuge. So in effect, they admit that there are options to alter the management within the lease lands using their senior water rights, but they decline to evaluate those options and include them in the management strategy. And so here on this record, the agency's decision is arbitrary and inconsistent with the statutory mandates because it includes no action to address that most pressing issue of water shortages.
Can I ask you about the mandate in the CUCL Act? Says the secretary shall, consistent with proper waterfowl management, continue the present pattern of leasing. So to what extent does that actually impose an obligation on fish and wildlife if it concludes that certain actions are consistent with proper waterfowl management to then allow agriculture?
Certainly, Honor, the statute does express, directs the agency to continue a certain level of agriculture to the extent it is consistent with waterfowl management. But here, the court cannot defer to that ultimate determination that this pattern of leasing is in fact consistent, because the decision itself is not rationally based on the agency's own definition of what constitutes proper waterfowl management, where the agency itself has identified proper waterfowl management as being focused on providing a diversity of habitats and food resources for all waterfowl species throughout the annual cycle. But in the compatibility determination is effectively prioritizing agricultural crops over wetland foods and focusing only on the needs of a small subset of waterfowl. And so the agency's determination there is arbitrary and is not rationally based on the facts in the record.
To follow up on Judge Bress's question, or maybe to ask the same question again, to what extent does the obligation or the statement that the pattern of agricultural use must be retained, what's that mean, or what constraint is there? Would that, for example, prevent the manager, the Fish and Wildlife Service from, I would say, for example, some leases come up for renewal and they just don't renew the leases? Would that prevent, would the pattern language prevent them from doing that?
No, Your Honor. It's Audubon's position, and clearly from the text of the CEQL Act, that Congress intended the agency to give full consideration to the level of agricultural use that is consistent with that major purpose, waterfowl management. And so in doing so, Congress created a management hierarchy where it prioritized waterfowl and wildlife over agricultural uses. And as the district court found, nothing in the text or the legislative history of the statute indicates an intention on Congress to require the agency to continue agricultural uses that may be inconsistent with waterfowl management. And so certainly the agency, if it engaged in the level of comparative analysis that Audubon is urging here with respect to the NEPA alternatives, that the agency could reach a different conclusion, that a lesser level of leasing is in fact consistent with proper waterfowl management and would better achieve the purposes of the refuge.
Just to follow up on Judge Fletcher's question, you're assuming in answering his question that the present pattern is inconsistent with waterfowl management. If you assume that it is consistent with waterfowl management, isn't your answer to Judge Fletcher's question that they could not discontinue the lease, or do you have a different answer?
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. If the agency made a decision that could be defended on the record that the present pattern of leasing was in fact consistent with proper waterfowl management, then yes, I believe that the statute would compel them to continue that level, but that's not the decision that the agency made here.
Okay.
How do you, I don't know, Judge Fletcher, if you wanted to move on or if I can just do.
Let's keep going as long as we have questions.
I mean, one feature of this Fish and Wildlife response to your client's position is that over time, basically, there's a codependency that's developed between agriculture and waterfowl, and now the birds depend on the waterfowl and agriculture. Now the birds are depending on the agriculture as a food source, and not only is it not necessarily harmful to the refuge, but now we actually may need it to keep a certain level of food available, again, consistent with our ability to get water. And so how do you address that in terms of why that was an unreasonable or irrational judgment?
Yes, thank you, Your Honor. Certainly the agricultural uses on the refuge are an essential component of refuge management, and Congress clearly acknowledged that in the KEKL Act when it directed these agricultural uses to continue. And it stated that the purpose of that is both to protect waterfowl and to preserve crops outside the refuges. But here, the agency has determined that agriculture, they're basically looking at it in a very narrow sense, despite the fact that they themselves have said the leased lands cannot be managed in isolation. Rather, they have to be managed as part of the refuge as a whole. And so here, where the rest of the refuge is almost entirely failing to support waterfowl, because there's no water for wetlands, it's not justifiable for the agency to continue 20,000 acres of commercial agriculture where the refuges are failing to support waterfowl elsewhere. There are other means of providing foods to waterfowl, for example, through the cooperative farming program, where grains are actually left for waterfowl food in comparison to the leased lands where crops are harvested entirely and waterfowl are left with what is referred to as waste grains. And so the agency's decision that continuing the full scale of leasing is consistent and compatible with waterfowl management is simply inconsistent with its own expert determinations as to what constitutes proper waterfowl management.
Okay, now I've not heard you make the argument here in your oral presentation, but you also have an argument about delegation to the Bureau of Reclamation.
That's correct, Your Honor, and that argument is strictly based on the text of the statute, which clearly vested all authority in the Fish and Wildlife Service to manage these refuges and created an exception for cooperative management with other agencies only with respect to wildlife refuges in the state of Alaska. And so the agency's delegation of authority to the Bureau of Reclamation is in excess of the agency's authority under the statute.
That is to say, the statute says that the administration cannot be delegated. What has been delegated to the Bureau of Reclamation, and can that fairly be characterized as delegation of administration?
Yes, Your Honor. So the Bureau of Reclamation is responsible for reviewing, approving, and enforcing the lease contracts. And as the record demonstrates, as cited in our brief, there have been circumstances in the past where Fish and Wildlife actually disagrees with management decisions of the Bureau of Reclamation in terms of when lands should be drained and how that should be prioritized. And so looking to the case, the Trustees for Alaska decision is very closely related to the action there that gave USGS the authority to review and approve mining exploration plans.
So in that case, and Trustees, assuming that that's even precedent since it was a district case that wasn't incorporated by reference, that was a delegation of statutory authority. The services says, well, in this contract, we retain all administrative authority and supervisory authority. Do you disagree with that?
The agency does ultimately decide through the compatibility determination, but they're not managing the day-to-day operations of the leasing activities. And that's really—
they have ultimate administrative authority. That's the argument in the contract itself that they retain authority. Do you disagree?
I don't disagree that the agency retains the authority to ultimately, through the overarching decision in the compatibility determination. However, the day-to-day operation and what the agency itself refers to as administration of the leasing program is carried out by the Bureau of Reclamation. And that's expressly contrary to what Congress directed in the statute, that the Fish and Wildlife Service, in fact, administer the refuges.
Yeah, I've been reading the, I guess they call it the cooperative agreement, and Bureau of Reclamation is actually doing quite a number of things, subject to what, overall disapproval, or does the Fish and Wildlife get into the fine grain and disagree with individual decisions? And I'm trying to figure out what the actual balance is under this agreement.
Yes, Your Honor, it's not entirely clear how much interaction the agency has, but my understanding is that they do not get involved in the granular decision making with respect to the lease contracts. But the Bureau of Reclamation really is in charge of that aspect. And Fish and Wildlife, once they've issued the compatibility determinations and the stipulations, does not have that much involvement in the actual operation of the leasing program.
I see in the, when we're dealing with, it's not your case, but obviously you're going to be familiar with this, if we're dealing with pesticides, the so-called PUP committee has membership of both the Fish and Wildlife Service and of the Bureau of Reclamation. What information do we have about how much responsibility Bureau of Reclamation has in that PUP process?
That's a good question, Your Honor.
This can be pesticide use on the leased lands, and there's been a delegation to Bureau of Reclamation with respect to leased lands, and so I'm now asking about the PUP committee for the leased lands.
Yes, Your Honor, and I apologize. I'm not sure I'm qualified to answer that particular question regarding the PUP process, but I would just point the court back to the language of the statute, which says the lands shall be administered by the service, and where Congress explicitly accepted cooperative management only for lands in Alaska. And so that has to be taken as Congress's intention that those types of cooperative management agreements could only continue on refuge lands in Alaska and not on other refuge lands as is being done here.
Okay. Any further questions from the bench for Ms. Fahey? Okay, you've asked to reserve a minute. We'll give you a minute on a rebuttal, and sometimes those minutes expand.
Okay, thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Ms. Fahey. I think Ms. Parent, you're next.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. Stephanie Parent for the Center for Biological Diversity. I'll reserve 1 minute for rebuttal. I'm going to focus on the Fish and Wildlife Service's treatment of the effects of the use of pesticides on agriculture on the Tule Lake and Lower Klamath refuges. This is because it's fundamental to the agency complying with its procedural duties under the National Environmental Policy Act, as well as its substantive duties under the Refuge and Kekal Acts. Here, the action is arbitrary and not in accordance with law because the service relies primarily on conclusory statements in the record to say that the effects of the use of pesticides on waterfowl, other wildlife, and their habitats are just minor. Under both the National Environmental Policy Act, or NEPA for short, and agency guidance to comply with the Refuge Act and make compatibility determinations, the agency must look at direct, indirect, and cumulative effects. And likewise, under the Kekal Act, to make the consistency determination, the agency uses the same, evaluates the same information. Now here in the record, the agency admits that current contamination threats and impacts were uncertain due to lack of monitoring data, and specific assessments do not exist. That's ER 455. Now, this complete lack of information means that the agency didn't have the data or analysis necessary to come to the conclusion under the Refuge and Kekal Acts that these pesticide uses will be compatible or consistent with waterfowl management or the refuge's purposes.
The services say that what they've approved is a procedure. They haven't approved individual pesticides, but have approved a procedure. Explain to me how that interacts with the determinations that you're concerned they didn't make.
Yes, Judge Okuda, the PUP process that it's important to note, they have only approved a procedure. And the reason that it's important that they look at the effects of the hundreds of pesticides that have been approved in the past and will be in the future is because there's no other place where the agency will do this analysis or disclose it to the public, which is of course required under NEPA. So the PUP process, it's important to note, is a secret behind closed doors process. So the public never has an opportunity to weigh in on that analysis. This is not the same as many other agency decisions where it's a staged decision-making process and they do.
Help me understand, are you saying that under NEPA, an agency could never adopt an adaptive management procedure, that they would have to have specific determinations in order for it to meet NEPA requirements?
No, Your Honor. What I'm saying is that here, the Comprehensive Conservation Plan is the only place where the agency is going to, in this EIS, and which is to guide the next 15 years, this is the only place where they will disclose that analysis because the PUP process is done behind closed doors. So it's not staged decision-making like often happens. You know, you have, for example, a forest plan, and then later you have a timber sale and the agency does additional NEPA and discloses the specific effects there. Here, that's not gonna happen. The PUP process does not go under any further NEPA analysis, and any analysis that's done is kept behind closed doors. The agency relies on the PUP process to say that the effects of pesticide use will only be minor, local, or temporary, because they only approve pesticide use that would be minor, local, or temporary. This is not only this is not only circular, but the agency has been undertaking these analyses in this PUP process for about 20 years. And it claims that it has the analysis. In fact, it claims that it has site-specific environmental data. That's ER at 969. Yet it refused to put any of that analysis into the record. So on the one hand, the agency claims it has it, including refuge-specific data. And on the other hand, they refuse to place it in the record. That certainly doesn't comply with NEPA. Moreover,
now, let me ask you to focus in the following way. As I see it, you've got three challenges with respect to the pesticide use. Number one is that they violate NEPA in failing to consider the alternative of reducing pesticide use. That's just, they didn't put that down as one of the alternatives. Number two, that they failed to take a hard look under NEPA. And then number three, this is a challenge not under NEPA, but rather under the Refuge Act and the CUSHL Act. Am I mistaking the nature of your arguments? Because I'm kind of hearing all three of them intermixed as you're going forward.
Yes, Your Honor. And the reason I, not only due to time, but because the agency needs to look at the same direct, indirect, and cumulative effects in order to make both its compatibility and consistency determinations under the Kekalin Refuge Act, and it has to do the same thing for NEPA. So they have multiple duties. NEPA is procedural. The Refuge Act is substantive. And okay, so
if I can focus just on the NEPA for just a moment, and for the moment, just the first of your NEPA argument, that is to say that they've not considered the alternative of reducing pesticide management. They've got three alternatives, but for the life of me, I can't tell the difference among them. They say that alternative C is the same as alternative B, so they say that's equivalent. But I don't see, and alternative A is no change. But I don't see the change between alternative A and alternative B for either Tule Lake or for Lower Klamath.
Yes,
is there a difference between alternative A and alternative B?
No, Your Honor, there's not. They all represent the status quo of using pesticides on the refuges through the PUP process, which again has not undergone does that site-specific analysis is not open to the public. So they've
simply not put forward as an alternative to be investigated under NEPA of reducing pesticide use.
No, Your Honor, and we suggested both in our comments and in briefing that there are reasonable alternatives.
I thought they explained that organic farming was not feasible because of the need for water use that wasn't available and some other reasons. So the procedures for not using pesticides at all were not feasible, and agricultural use was necessary for food and wildlife and therefore pesticides. So there was some discussion of it. Was that discussion inadequate in your view?
No, Your Honor. First, I'll point out that the Tule Lake and the Lower Klamath refuges both have the same purposes of, you know, native bird breeding habitat and the primary purpose of waterfowl management. On the Lower Klamath Refuge, the agency restricts the use of pesticides to only a few herbicides. But meanwhile, on the Tule Lake Refuge, the agency, there's a list of about 100 pesticides that include insecticides, fungicides, herbicides that the agency allows to be used there to grow food that also is intended in some part to provide forage for the waterfowl to meet that proper waterfowl management requirement.
So the government said that the Lower Klamath Refuge involves vastly larger farmland, so a greater variety of pest management tools was required. Was that arbitrary and capricious to reach that determination comparing Tule Lake with Lower Klamath?
No, Your Honor, and part of the problem here is that these are the types of issues the agency should have analyzed and evaluated in the record.
That was from the record. That's what I gleaned from the record.
I meant in the EIS. First of all, we have information in the brief that organic farming is feasible. It's occurring on a percentage of the refuge already. The fact that the lease land on the Tule Lake may be larger, there's no basis for saying then pesticides are necessary. So again, that was just a conclusory statement that they had to.
Are we supposed to defer to the scientific judgment of the agency on those sorts of issues?
I don't believe it was based on scientific judgment, Your Honor. The basis is kind of an outdated notion that organic farming is not feasible, and they base it on the market. And organic farming has progressed. And I want to point out that that's also something of a straw man argument. The agency took took our suggestions, like reducing the use of onions, which are incredibly insecticide intensive, and they don't provide food for waterfowl. So that's one feasible alternative that wouldn't require the agency to prohibit all use of pesticides. Moreover, in the last 20 years, pesticides have really changed. There are a number of alternatives that could be less, have less impact on waterfowl and other wildlife in their habitats.
But if I can interrupt you for just a minute, I understand your NEPA argument basically to be that they haven't even considered the alternative. I mean, all three alternatives are essentially maintaining the status quo.
Yes, Your Honor.
So to say, well, here's what they should have done if they had considered the alternative, in a sense, is to put the cart before the horse. They haven't even considered the alternative.
Exactly, Judge Fletcher. And therefore, this under NEPA and the alternatives argument, the agency's action is not supported, and it's arbitrary and capricious. I'd like to, if I may, get back to the PUP program and the problem with relying upon it to claim that there are there's only minor effects. There's contrary evidence in the record, Your Honor, that the agency only approves pesticides through that process that have minor effects. In fact, you know, we've pointed them out in our brief. There are pesticides that the agency has said were an unacceptable hazard to wildlife, yet they continue to approve them. The agency had a 2009 list of 12 high-risk pesticides that needed to be subject to replacement because of the impacts on wildlife, yet they continue to approve 11 of those 12 through 2016, which is the most recent information we have in the record. And finally, with respect to effects, the agency also admits that the PUP process it uses to identify specific pesticide products does not address cumulative effects, including...
Sorry, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to add, Your Honor, that, you know, pesticide, we demonstrated in the brief that many, many pesticides are being used on the refuge, often on the same piece of agricultural crops. And exposure to an insecticide, let's say a which is approved there, imidacloprid, has certain effects on species in their habitat. Well, at the same time, the agency has allowed the use of the herbicide dicamba, which is also prone to drift and has other impacts on the same species in the same habitat. And the agency admitted in the ER at 581, 439, and 892 that the analysis it does in the secret pup process does not look at cumulative effects.
I'm sorry, I did not hear that. Does not, then you dropped your voice.
It does not look at cumulative effects. It does not address cumulative effects.
Okay. Any further questions from the bench for Ms. Parent? Okay, thank you. Next up is going to be Mr. Purcell.
May it please the court, Your Honors, John Purcell for Appellant Western Watersheds Project. I'd like to reserve 1 minute for rebuttal.
Okay.
Clear Lake Refuge is home to the last breeding ground for a struggling sage-grouse population, and it also provides critical habitat for two endangered fish species. And I want to discuss two main points regarding the CCP and Clear Lake Refuge. First, the Fish and Wildlife Service violated NEPA by eliminating reduced and no grazing alternatives from consideration. And second, the service also violated NEPA by failing to take a hard look at impacts to sage-grouse and endangered fish from livestock grazing on the refuge. So starting with alternatives, an agency's consideration of a full range of reasonable alternatives is designed to serve NEPA's dual purposes of informed decision-making and meaningful public participation. And that full range is defined by the purpose and need for a project. And for the CCP and Clear Lake Refuge, the service offered a very broad purpose and need centered around the refuge's purpose as a breeding ground for native birds and for wildlife conservation. And the other important thing to remember is that under the Muckleshoot Indian Tribe versus Forest Service decision, an agency's stated reasons for eliminating an alternative from consideration must be factually supported based on meaningful analysis and explain why the alternative would not meet the purpose and need for a project. Now, the EIS itself is where the service's reasoning must be found, and any rationalizations beyond that are post hoc, and that's where the district court and the response briefs go wrong. It's a bedrock principle that an agency must defend its action on the reasons it gave at the time it acted. And in this case, the service offered just two reasons for eliminating reduced grazing from detailed consideration in the agency's response to public comments. That's pages 393 to 394 of our excerpts of record. So the first reason offered by the service is that grazing is a management method to reduce invasive species. But the service never explains why reduced grazing would not also reduce invasive species. And this court has held that an agency may not leap to an assumption that only one option can achieve a narrow task. That's from Iliuulau-Kalani Coalition versus Rumsfeld. So the second reason the service offered is another conclusory statement with no factual support that the service believes expanding grazing will improve habitat and reduce grazing will have the opposite effect. But under NEPA, that kind of judgment can only be made after a rigorous public comparison of alternatives. And the service here turned that process on its head and ended its inquiry before even beginning it, which is impermissible. Neither of those two reasons the service gave actually refer to the purposes of the CCP or the refuge. And the reality is that reduced or no grazing can reduce invasive species and restore sage-grouse habitat, as the Beshta and Reisner studies in the record show. That's on pages 455 and 472 of our excerpts of record. Now, this court held in Western Watersheds Project versus Abbey that because reduced grazing could feasibly meet a project's goal and operate in a more friendly way toward a national monument's protected objects, that reduced grazing alternatives must be considered in detail in a site-specific analysis. And the facts here are parallel. Clear Lake Refuge was set aside as a breeding ground for native birds and for wildlife conservation, and reduced or no grazing might be less harmful to the sage-grouse and endangered fish that the refuge supports, serving the purposes and the goals of the refuge. Now, the holding in Abbey controls this case, and it's telling that the service doesn't even try to distinguish it. And in fact, this court has never held that an EIS with a similarly broad purpose and need satisfies NEPA by evaluating only the continuation of current management or no action and a single agency preferred action alternative. But that's what the service did here. Now, I want to turn to our hard look claims. The service.
Can I ask you a question about this? It's kind of just a kind of on the ground factual question.
Yes,
the preferred alternative is to expand the grazing alternative, the grazing that now exists, and the expanded grazing would be on the, I guess, the west side of the so-called U in a couple of specifically designated areas, but there's also existing grazing. Where on the U is that existing grazing taking place, and do we have any evidence that tells us whether it's on the same area where the LEK, the LEK is, that is to say the breeding ground? Because maybe it's in there. I tried to find it, but I couldn't find it. What do we know about that? About the existing grazing and its relationship to the LEK?
From what I understand, Your Honor, the existing grazing occurs on the U Peninsula on the refuge between August and November. And the LEK is on that U Peninsula. And I don't have the record site right in front of me that says that, but that is, I believe, when and where that grazing occurs and where the LEK is.
But the grazing on the U that's existing is not fenced off in any particular area on the U?
There's currently no fencing, but under this proposal that the service adopted, new fencing would be erected on the east side of the U Peninsula. And
for the new grazing,
a new spring grazing period during the sage-grouse nesting season, so between March and April. And that's where the service failed to take a hard look, because the service said that no sage-grouse hens nest on this east side of the U due to a lack of sagebrush cover. But that's simply not the case. Nesting data from the state of California that was in the service's possession show that hens nested on this side of the U every year between 2007 and 2012.
I'm a little puzzled by the arguments and what we've heard from the other of your colleagues here, that the services was wrong in making its determination, scientific determination, evaluation of the evidence. What's our standard in reviewing the arguments that, well, the services is just wrong in its scientific determination?
Well, you're under-
there's a great deal in the record we haven't reviewed at all, and we're not scientists. So the normal rule is we defer to the services' judgment on those sorts of things. But the types of arguments I'm hearing are, no, they were simply wrong in making their determination. So I'm wondering what you think our review should be on based on.
Thank you, Your Honor. Under the Refuge Act, the service needs to exercise sound professional judgment, and the service actually defines that to take into account all available science and evidence before it. And from our perspective, the service has not done that here. And tying it back to our NEPA claims.
And they've rejected, they have not reviewed the data, if expressly said, we will not review this information, or there was material information you don't think they reviewed, or they reviewed it, but they just came out a different way. Which category do you think is applicable here?
Your Honor, with regards to two particular studies, Besht and Reisner, which I mentioned before, which are on pages 455 and 472 of our excerpts of record, we have not seen where the service has actually taken into consideration or grappled with that science that shows that the cessation or reduction of livestock grazing can in fact reduce invasive species and restore sage grouse habitat. So that analysis is missing, and there's no factual support that the service has offered why reduction of grazing cannot also restore sagebrush habitat and serve the purposes of this refuge. And I wanna circle back a little bit to the nesting data from the state of California. The service had nesting data in its possession that showed hens nested on the east side of the U Peninsula. And by ignoring this data and claiming that there were no hens nesting here, the service did not take a hard look at impacts to sage grouse during its nesting season. And the service knows and has acknowledged in the past that livestock can trample nests, prevent nest attempts, and cause nest abandonment. So without a fact-based analysis here of the impacts of this new spring grazing season, there just has not been a hard look and the service has violated NEPA. Now,
this continues to be a NEPA argument. Are you also making a compatibility argument in the sense of they did not make an appropriate judgment with respect to compatibility with the Refuge Act or the Pupil Act, or is this purely a NEPA argument?
Thank you, Your Honor. Yes, we do have a claim that the service violated the Refuge Act in its compatibility determination, particularly with regards to this new spring grazing period on the east side of the U. Again, because it has not grappled with that science that I mentioned that shows that the cessation or reduction of grazing is actually better for sage grouse and restoration of sage grouse habitat. And as well,
I have to say, I'm sympathetic to the concern raised by Judge Ikuda. I mean, at some point, I guess if the agency simply disregards a whole slew of evidence that points one way and seizes on something that's clearly insubstantial, we can say they didn't do a hard look, but I'm not sure I want to be sort of rejudging the scientific evidence that the agency's already judged. Is it that extreme that the agency, there's just no possible way of justifying their decision?
Thank you, Your Honor. Well, looking again at the nesting data, the service simply has not acknowledged that hens do in fact nest on the east side of the U, and that impacts will occur to sage grouse during their nesting season from this new grazing period in the spring. So,
as I read what the agency did with respect to the nesting data, is they said, well, we tagged, and they don't say how many, we've tagged some sage grouse and none have been detected. That's what they say.
And Your Honor, respectfully, I believe that's referring to the service's internal data, but it's not taking into account the state of California's nesting data that shows otherwise.
So you're just saying that they've cherry-picked the data, they've given us some and not talked about the other?
Yes, Your Honor. The service has not acknowledged that sage-grouse do nest on this side of the U Peninsula, and this new grazing period will be during the nesting season. So, you know, fewer nesting attempts will occur and fewer nest successes will occur if this grazing period is implemented. Now, I also want to talk about the failure of the service to take a hard look at impacts to endangered fish from livestock grazing on the refuge. Now, Clear Lake's shoreline is critical habitat for these fish, especially at their juvenile stages. And the service argued that impacts to fish from grazing would only be minor, but at the same time claimed it had no empirical data on the matter. And that's, again, just simply not true. The service did actually have evidence of its own that grazing harms the fish because the agency had prepared a biological opinion that looked at impacts from grazing on the adjacent Modoc National Forest on these same endangered fish. And it found that grazing impacts the fish when cows trample nearshore habitat. And under this adopted alternative, cattle will have unimpeded access to Clear Lake's shoreline for half the year. And during four of those months, most of the cattle use is on the shoreline. So impacts to these fish are not only occasional or of short duration, which is where the district court went wrong and wrongly offered those post hoc rationalizations. So bottom line, the service violated NEPA by failing to take a hard look at impacts to both sage grouse and these endangered fish species from grazing on the refuge. And I'll reserve any further time or take any further questions.
One quick question. As between the two, sage grouse and suckerfish, I know you maintain that there was not a hard look given to either, but would you say that this, in your view, the service's failures were worse for one species as opposed to the other?
Well, thank you, Judge Brass. No, I wouldn't argue that the failure to take a hard look was worse in one situation than the other. In both situations, the agency simply did not take into account data that was before it. With the sage grouse, the nesting data from the state of California, with the endangered fish, its previous biological opinion that looked at grazing on the Modoc National Forest. So I believe the failure is just as egregious in both instances.
Thanks.
Okay, no more questions from the bench at this time. Thank you. And now, next on the list is Ms. Johnson.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. I am Brittany Johnson, and I will be arguing on behalf of Tule Lake Irrigation District and the other agricultural plaintiff appellants. I'd like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal.
Okay, now I think we're gonna hear from you twice, is that right? We're gonna hear from you now as an appellant, and we'll hear from you later as an appellee.
Well, my block of time is continuous, so the first part of the 15 minutes, 7.5 minutes will be as plaintiff appellant, and then the latter 7.5 minutes will be as defendant appellee in the other three cases.
Okay, so let's start out with you as appellant then. Okay, you're now an appellant.
Thank you. My argument will start by addressing the statutory interpretation issues that are raised in TID's appeal and that relate to lands that have been dedicated to agriculture for over 100 years. TID's position is that the plain language of the statute requires continued leasing and agriculture under certain conditions. That language is found in Section 4 of the CEQA Act, which directs the secretary to continue leasing, to limit row crops to 25%, and to maximize lease revenues for the benefit of the local agencies. The language in Section 4 applies to a specific set of lands identified in a plat map from 1956 that are located in Tule Lake and Lower Klamath refuges. These are called the lease lands. Section 4 then must be read in conjunction with Section 2, which contains language that applies to all reserved lands in all four refuges that are created by the CEQA Act or given statutory status by the CEQA Act. Section 2 also makes clear that this compromise was about homesteading. For many decades, there was debate about whether all the lands in the Klamath Basin would be homesteaded under the reclamation laws. And that debate included wildlife advocates. This led to a compromise in the CEQA Act where the lands would be retained in federal ownership, but leased for agricultural crops, and then they would not be available for homesteading. So that's really what the Keep Alive Act is about.
Well, I mean, does your argument boil down to saying whatever the present pattern of leasing was, that cannot be reduced, that is a floor?
Well, our argument is really about whether the secretary has authority under the KECO Act to make a consistency determination. And that's the question before the court. So it is our position that the KECO Act does not provide for a consistency determination, whether the service.
Okay, I'm struggling with that because the language says shall, consistent with proper waterfowl management, continue the present pattern of leasing. And so whether it's unambiguous, I mean, why wouldn't that at least allow the Fish and Wildlife to have a consistency determination? It doesn't seem to foreclose that, at least.
Well, the phrase consistent with proper waterfowl management is set off by commas, and we know that that indicates that it is a non-restrictive clause under the rules of grammar. That doesn't mean that you're supposed to read the words out of the statute in contravention of canons and statutory interpretation. It means that those words are not essential to the meaning of shall continue the present pattern of leasing.
I don't follow that at all. I just read the sentence and it says, you should do this consistent with X. And if it's not consistent with it, well, you can't do it.
Well, the question again is whether the service can make that determination and a consistency determination and restrict agriculture. We would argue that Congress already made that determination in Section 4 and gave specific direction to the service on how leasing would be consistent with with waterfowl management. And that would be to limit the crop patterns to only 25% row crops so that the remaining lands would be dedicated to grains and the waste would be available to waterfowl. Another way that leasing or Congress directed that leasing is already consistent with proper waterfowl management is to maximize the lease revenues. And that is because those lease revenues were dedicated by contract to the local irrigation district and to the counties to make up or to offset the lost revenue that would have been received by those agencies in taxes if the land had been transferred to private ownership.
So the services have provided a different interpretation of Section 4. Are they entitled to deference for that interpretation, or do we not defer?
No, you should not defer to the service in this instance. Chevron deference only applies to certain agency actions. That is both U.S. Supreme Court precedent and Ninth Circuit precedent. And those are actions that carry the force of law. Here, there are two Ninth Circuit precedents that are cited in our briefs, Wilderness Watch and Wilderness Society, in which the Ninth Circuit has held that these type of planning documents or permitting decisions are not the type of agency actions to which Chevron deference would apply. Wilderness Watch involved a management plan with conflicting statutory directives. Again, the Ninth Circuit found that long-term management plan for refuges is not an action to which Chevron deference would apply. And then Wilderness Society involved a permitting decision for what was argued to be a commercial enterprise in a refuge. And again, the Ninth Circuit found that that type of permitting decision does not warrant Chevron deference.
So do you think this making a conservation plan is akin to a specific individual permit to a applicant?
Well, I think both precedents apply to the different interpretations. Here you have Appendix M, which is the legal interpretation in the conservation plan, and that would be the Wilderness Watch precedent. But then if you looked at the compatibility determination, that is more akin to a permit decision, and then Wilderness Society would apply to that. So in each situation where there's a legal determination about what the KECO Act means, whether that's the CCP or the compatibility determination, a Ninth Circuit precedent would apply and hold that that is not an agency action subject to Chevron deference.
I guess I'm still struggling though with what you think the phrase consistent with proper waterfowl management is doing in that section.
Well, again, it's a non-restrictive clause. It's also an adjectival phrase that would define what the continued present pattern of leasing is. Congress effectively said that the continued present pattern of leasing is consistent with proper waterfall management. The way federal defendants or the other plaintiff appellants argue the case, they cannot argue it without inserting words into that sentence. You heard Ms. Fay this morning say, to the extent that leasing is consistent with proper waterfall management. Those words don't exist in the statute. It also, if you look towards the end of section four, you see a callback to section two, which has the different management standard for all other reserved lands in the refuges. And that shows that those two sections work in conjunction together so that there's a specific management direction for the leased lands and a much broader management direction for all other reserved lands. There's also other extrinsic sources of information that the court can consider in interpreting the statute. And those would include the history and development of the lands, that these lands were ceded to the federal government by the states of California and Oregon for reclamation purposes, and the history of the KEQA Act and when it was adopted. And there's also the TID contract, which again is an extrinsic source of information that the court can consider in interpreting the statute. So I would go back to Judge Bress's question that the question is really whether there is authority under the KEQA Act to issue a consistency determination. Whether the service wanted to regulate agriculture under some authority, that's not the question in this case. And those aren't the facts before the court, but whether the KEQA Act requires a consistency determination. And then the alternative for
whether it allows for one, I mean, that's... That's the language here. The secretary shall, consistent with proper waterfowl management, continue. And I take it you're reading it to basically mean that the present pattern of leasing is consistent with proper waterfowl management. I'm not sure that's a permissible reading of that phrase, but I'm also not sure it's required either.
What TID would argue is that it doesn't call for a consistency determination, that Congress already, by the words of the statute in section four, and comparing that to the context and design of the statute as a whole, comparing it to section two with the broader management direction for all other reserved lands, as well as section one and the policies of preserving existing habitat. Those were the leased lands, the agricultural crops
if it were to become crystal clear that the present pattern of leasing was devastating to the waterfowl, fish and wildlife, they would have no power to address that?
Not under the KEQA Act. There's obviously other authorities that the service would consider and whether to take action to remedy that hypothetical fact. Pattern, but under the KEQA Act, no, there would be no discretion to issue a consistency determination.
Okay, do you want to switch from being an appellant to an appellee?
Yes, Your Honor, thank you very much. I wanted to make a few points in response to Ms. Fay's argument in the Audubon Society of Portland appeal, and that is about this false dichotomy that Audubon's creating between agriculture and refuges. It is in fact true under the water rights that apply in the Klamath Basin that if the agricultural lands did not receive delivery of water, that there would be no water deliveries for the refuges. And that is just because of the water supply challenges in the basin, and that most of the water right now is being dedicated to ESA purposes in Upper Klamath Lake to retain minimum levels, and then in the lower Klamath River to provide minimum flows for threatened coho salmon. So to answer the earlier question from one of the judges, those leased lands would not receive delivery of water if it were not for the agricultural irrigation and the water right. There was also...
How do we know that? I mean, I read that and I was trying to figure that out, but you're telling us then that if these agricultural lands or some part of the agricultural lands were taken out of production, that water would not go to any of the refuges, but it would go somewhere else?
Yes, that is true.
And how do we know that?
Well, it would start with the definition of the water rights, and those, the agricultural lands have a 1905 irrigation right that was defined in the adjudication order that was issued in 2014. refuge lands have a much more junior right from 1928. That's a federal reserved right, not an appropriative right under state law. We also know that, so it would start with that water right. Then you would go into the practical reality on the ground that if the water was not delivered to irrigation, it would be used by another contractor. The refuge lands aren't actually part of the project. There's hundreds of contracts with the for project water. So that water would likely be allocated to other project contractors that pay for the water and the operation and maintenance costs of the project. And then there's just the physical reality that there was a study in 2002 that if water were not delivered, that weeds would actually consume just as much water as agriculture. And so that is why the service has elected over time not to take action to reduce agriculture, because it would just turn the lands into weeds. And we actually know this based on what has happened in 2021, when agricultural lands have, in the current drought, received zero water from the project, and Sump 1A and 2 Lake Refuge is currently dry.
Okay, thank you.
There was another anecdote about from Audubon, Portland, about an instance in 2013 where agricultural crops were prioritized over wetlands. And we addressed that issue in pages 50 to 52 of our answering brief. That was actually a problem created by the ESA, and water needed to be maintained in Upper Klamath Lake to meet minimum lake levels for endangered sucker species. So if you go through the record and you read that email chain, you'll actually see that both the service and reclamation were trying to address an issue created by minimum lake levels as a result of the Endangered Species Act regulation. Oh, and I have stats too still. going to the pesticide committee, or sorry, the question about for the CBD appeal on whether the pesticide use of the PUP committee, whether reclamation runs that or the service. The service runs that, and they effectively make determinations about which pesticides can and can't be used by the refuges.
Is that all behind closed doors and secret meetings, as the CBD attorneys concluded?
No, I don't think it's on a Zoom hearing, but I do. There are county reports. There is, you know, effectively five levels of regulations of pesticides on the lease lands: the federal level, the state level, the county agricultural commissioner level, which is where entities that apply pesticides have to report their usage. And then you have the PUP process that is run by the service. And also there are contract provisions in the lease contracts about how pesticides are to be used. So that is two extra levels of regulations that do not apply to adjacent private lands that are just next door in the basin.
But what I'm trying to figure out is what, because we are in the refuges and we're not, so there are different criteria that would govern pesticide use in terms of furtherance of good waterfowl management and so on. What do we know about the PUP process in terms of what pesticides they authorize for which fields, in what quantities, and when they're applied? I mean, what information is there that we're missing? I've tried to look into what PUP information there is available, and it seems to tell us that this pesticide has been approved, but it doesn't tell me in what quantities, how often applied, and so on. Is that information available to the PUP but not available to the decision maker? I mean, what's going on here? I mean, what part's available? What's public and what's not public?
I think it's all currently public. Whether it's, you know, available on a website, you'd have to request that information.
That can't be right, because there was a discovery request in the district court which was opposed. So I mean, obviously, on the ground that you can't have it. Not that there's no such thing.
I'll let federal defendants answer whether they responded to the FOIA request adequately. But the PUP the PUP reports do provide data on how much pesticides are applied, the time, the duration, which crops are grown. I mean, the level of regulation of pesticides on the refuges is far and above what occurs on any other agricultural land in the basin. And this is a 200,000 acre large, the Klamath Basin is 200,000 acres. What we're talking about here is a subset of lands. There's 6,000 acres in Lower Klamath that is dedicated to grain, and another 14 to 15,000 acres in Chili Lake. And those acres have far fewer pesticides that are allowed than just if you had private land across the street and you would only have to apply with the county agricultural commissioner regulations. But the PU reports, I think they're from 2013 and 2014. They are in the administrative record. I don't know how many pages of them. There are hundreds and thousands of pages made it into the excerpts of record. But the type of information you're looking for would be in those PUP reports.
Okay.
I did want to address one question from Judge Fletcher about the difference in pesticide alternatives. We go through the alternatives on pages 81 through 83 of our answering brief. It's not just the IPM alternatives. You also have to consider the agricultural management alternatives and how pesticides are treated in those, and reading the alternatives analysis together. For example, the walking wetlands program, that is actually a pest management tool, because as you take land out of production and flood it, the pests on the land will be reduced. So when you read those kinds of provisions as part of the agricultural habitat managements and read them in conjunction with the IPM alternatives, there is a wide range of alternatives that were considered by the service.
Yeah, I have to say I disagree. I read as hard as I could to find as many differences as I could between alternative A, alternative B for both Tule Lake and for the Lower Klamath. I had real trouble finding much difference. It seemed to me that alternative B, which was the one that was different from alternative A, was just describing practices that actually already existed under our alternative A. It's just they weren't described as part of alternative A. But this looked to me like they were just describing existing practices.
I would respectfully disagree, Your Honor, and again, direct you to pages 81 to 83. The expansion of the walking wetland program, where acknowledged just a few hundred acres, the service is now proposing to have at least wetlands within a 1 mile of every agricultural acre. That in itself is a pest management alternative, whether it's labeled as pest management under the IPM label of alternatives, that's found in the agricultural habitat management alternatives. I think you have to read the alternatives analysis together to get the full range.
Yeah.
The one other point that I wanted to respond to as part of Ms. Parent's argument, the idea that only herbicides are applied in Lower Klamath versus Tule Lake. Pesticide management is a function of many things. Right now, grains are grown on Lower Klamath because it's cooler and wetter, and that's what can be grown at yields that are actually create an incentive for people to lease the land. Row crops are now grown on Tule Lake. So yes, there are different pesticides that are applied between Lower Klamath and Tule Lake, but that's a function of soil health and marking conditions, hydrology and climate. It's not some grand scheme by the service to increase pesticide use between the refuges. So if there are no other questions, I'll save the rest of my time for rebuttal.
The rest of your time, yeah, right. We'll give you a chance to respond.
But thank you.
Everyone is exceeding a lot of time by design, I should say. All right, next we're going to hear from Mr. Burney.
Yes, thank you, Your Honors, and good morning. As Magistrate Judge Clark and Judge McShane correctly concluded, the service's resolution of the many highly complex and technical issues in this case was reasonable and consistent with the KEEQL Act, NEPA, and the Refuge Act. I obviously have a lot of ground to cover here. I just want to make, if I could, three overarching points that I think it's important to understand in thinking about the CCP here, and then I'll move on to the individual cases, subject to the court's questions, of course. The first point I wanted to make is that the service's determination of the various activities at issue was consistent with refuge purposes, is really consistent with history and longstanding practices on the refuges. So As to Audubon's challenge, as TID notes, the Leased Land Agriculture Program has been going on since 1916, so pretty much exactly a century before the CCP was issued. As to WWP's challenge, grazing has been going on at Clear Lake since the 1800s, and the service previously concluded in the 1996 that grazing was a beneficial use. And as to CBD's challenge, the service has long concluded that pesticides are an important tool of last resorts. And of course, there has been an IPM in place for the leased land since 1998, which the service drew on its experience on that plan in part to determine that an expansion of an IPM to the non-leased lands was appropriate. And the second point I want to make, and I think this is important, is the CCP is a programmatic document. And I think, again, that applies to all of the non-TID challenges. So for example, Audubon criticizes the service for not doing enough to increase the quantity of water available to the refuges. As I think Judge Bress's questions illustrate, this, and as does our brief, the service has very limited control over these issues. But the point is that the service continues to consider possible additional steps that may improve things on the refuge, including some of Audubon's proposals. As to WWP's challenge, I think it's important to note that although the CCP authorizes a new program of spring grazing, the CCP also notes that this will be implemented flexibly. And in fact, the service has not actually authorized spring grazing on Clear Lake at any point since the CCP was issued. And as to CBD's challenge, as Judge Jakuta's questions point out, the IPM process is just that, a process. It is neutral regarding the quantity of pesticides to be approved and the best management practices that will accompany them. And finally, the third point I want to make is that with the exception of TID's statutory challenge, which we think just plainly fails on the merits, the other three challenges in this case are really attempts to second-guess the service's technical judgment on complex scientific and technical issues. So turning to the challenges, I suppose I'll address them in the order that we addressed them in the brief.
Can I ask a question at this point? I'm quite sympathetic to the notion that you're advancing, that we're not in a position to second-guess any scientific judgment. I totally get that. But where I have my primary stumbling point as I go through these three challenges by the environmental groups is that various alternatives are not considered. And NEPA is very clear that you've got to consider viable alternatives. You can reject them, but you've got to consider them. And I, as I keep going through the challenges, I don't see that that the service has considered them.
Well, I mean, I will address those in order. I mean, of course, a rule of reason applies to the service's consideration of alternatives. I mean, as to Audubon's challenge, the service expressly rejected in leasing a consideration of an elimination of agricultural leasing alternative. I think that's on pages 376 to 377 on the Audubon excerpts of record. And the reason why it did so, as the service explained, are quite obvious. First of all, under the Oregon state adjudication, under which agriculture has a much higher priority date than uses for wetlands or refuge purposes, the continued viability of agriculture is critical to for water availability on the refuges. And the service and agriculture also provides necessary food for waterfowl, and the service explains elsewhere in the record that it's important to that it's vitally important that there be a wide diversity of food available for waterfowl, including agricultural and natural foods, and that agricultural foods in some cases have higher energy than natural foods. So it's obvious why a reduced leasing alternative.
Can I interrupt for just a minute?
Certainly.
But the proposal from Audubon wasn't merely that the service had to consider the elimination of agriculture, but the reduction of agriculture. And so when you say, well, some of this agriculture is used to feed the waterfowl, that's right, but that's on a very small percentage of the acreage that's actually in the cooperative program. Most of the agriculture, as you know, is in the lease program, and there's nothing that left for the waterfowl from that, except it's sort of accidental gleanings around the edge of the field. So you're in a sense taking the only the easy argument, which is to say, well, there's no way that we should consider the elimination of all agriculture, but what about reduction? Because I think that's where the thrust of the argument is.
Well,
why doesn't the government have to consider the reduction of land for agricultural uses?
I mean,
or perhaps the alteration of it so that more land is moved into the cooperative system away from the leased system.
So a couple of things, Your Honor. First of all, I think you and Ms. Fahey mentioned that that all that's available for waterfowl is waste. In fact, the CCP includes carefully tailored stipulations, including, I think this is on page 342 of Audubon's excerpts of record, requirements that the lease program provide certain quantities of food for waterfowl through a bioenergetics program. So I think the stipulations address that and ensure that the leased land program is in fact meeting its purpose of providing sufficient food for waterfowl. As for reducing the leased land program, I mean, I think the service addressed that also on pages 376 to 377 of the excerpts of record as well. What the service said is it wouldn't do any good because all it would do was, as Ms. Johnson said, I think correctly, was send water to higher priority uses and also result in large weed infestations, which are incompatible with waterfowl needs. So I think the service plainly addressed why farming is critical to is not only consistent with proper waterfowl management, but critical to it. And I think in this regard, Your Honor, Ms. Johnson's point about the Kekal Act is important to keep in mind as well. I mean, we actually agree with a lot of what is being said about how in the Kekal Act, Congress recognized the importance of the existing farming program, envisioned that it's continued. We get off the bus at the conclusion. We think the statute is clear under Section 4 and Section 2 that we're allowed to impose stipulations on the leased land program to the extent with system proper waterfowl management. But even if there are other ways to provide food for waterfowl, I think the Kekal Act, in addition to the reasonableness of the service's compatibility determinations, adds another gloss to this and further underscores the reasonableness of the service's determination. But the overarching point is the service made clear throughout that the leased land program in particular is critical to provide adequate food for waterfowl, as well as ensuring a reliable supply of water under Oregon law. If I could turn
before you make that transition point, I mean, isn't it also the case that although the total acreage was not reduced, there were some restrictions, stipulations put on agriculture use that did reduce it in various different ways. Those are the things that TIL says that you couldn't do. And so those were part of the actual plan that was adopted here.
No, that's exactly right, Judge Bress. I mean, I whether you put that in terms of a reduction in leasing or not, I think TID's presence in this case illustrates that. I mean, there's the expansion of the walking wetlands program and the other stipulations placed in. So, I mean, farming is certainly regulated on these refuges. I mean, on the water situation, which I think underlies a lot of Audubon's claims, I think some of the questioning is exactly right. The service made clear that they just have limited control over these issues. I thought I heard Ms. Fahey say that, well, the service did not justify its options in terms of limited control. With respect, that's simply not true. I mean, our entire explanation in the brief about the constraints faced by the service is in the CCP in several places. I think pages 301 to 308 of Audubon's excerpts of record, one place where this is all spelled out, and that this is all essential to understanding the service's water management plan. In terms of viable alternatives, the service did not neglect any viable alternatives in its water management plan. As we mentioned in our brief, the service continues to explore options, including recently transferring certain water rights from Upper Klamath to Lower Klamath. Ms. Fahey referenced page 642 of the excerpts of record where the service discussed this. I would actually encourage the court to look at the service's discussion of this issue, because you'll see the service doesn't just say You know, we'll look at this later. What the service goes into detail regarding the practical difficulties, for example, of transferring water rights from the Lost River Basin in terms of electricity and other issues, and really provides a fulsome discussion of the obstacles associated with, but goes on to say that the service will consider and attempt to implement those options throughout the life of the CCP. I don't see any legal requirement that service do more than that, or how it could have done more than that. I want to address briefly the arguments about the Walking Wetlands Program. The Walking Wetlands Program, there are a few problems, I think, with Audubon's reliance on that. I mean, first of all, the CCP contains a substantial expansion of the Walking Wetlands Program on Tule Lake, ensuring that all lease lands are within 1 mile of a walking wetland. And as for Lower Klamath, the service's explanation was that grain is sufficiently interspersed throughout the refuge because of the much smaller acreage of farming on Lower Klamath, such that walking wetlands was not necessary. And we think that was certainly reasonable. The service also made clear that although, you know, walking wetlands as a farming method is consistent with the Oregon State Court adjudication, converting all lease lands, there are constraints on that. The converting all lease lands to wetlands would not be consistent with either the Kegel Act or Oregon State law. I think there was also some discussion of this claim regarding the Bureau of Reclamation. Judge Okuda, you asked sort of what authority the services to Bureau of Reclamation has. I mean, this is made clear with in the cooperative agreement itself, which is long, in keeping with the history theme of this. This is longstanding, a 44-year-old arrangement. It says, I think it's on page 609 of the Audubon excerpts of record. It makes clear that everything the Bureau of Reclamation does is subject to the Bureau's ultimate control. And, you know, as a practical matter, there's a reason that the Bureau of Reclamation
I'm on page 609. Where does it say subject to the ultimate control of the service?
I apologize, Your Honor. Would you like me to retrieve it?
No, you know, it's not worth. I'll take your reference. I'll just read it to you because I think it's consistent with what you said, but I don't think it's inconsistent with the notion that, nonetheless, the Bureau is doing some administration. I think the language you're referring to. The decision of the service shall be binding with respect to any matter relating to or arising out of the administration of such areas, provided, however, that in the event of any dispute between the service and the Bureau as any such matter, the service shall consult with the Bureau. I think that's the language you're referring to.
Right, that is the language I was referring to, Your Honor. And yes, I mean, I think that makes clear that...
But what I want to say is having ultimate control is somewhat different from actually engaging in the administration. So the question is what's meant by the term administration and what's being delegated. If it's sort of day-to-day management subject to the possible ultimate control, well, that may be administration and we may be violating the anti-delegation provision. So my problem is what's meant by administration, and the term is within our boundaries self-defining, but maybe in the fine grain not.
Right. So, I mean, I think our interpretation of administer means you know, when for example, you know, the Supreme Court refers to something administered by a statute administered by an agency for Chevron purposes, it's talking about doing things like issuing rules and things like that. And that's what we think administer means, is exercise substantive control. I think that's quite distinct from the day-to-day management that the service has been relying on the Bureau of Reclamation for nearly half a century. I mean, the service determines, first of all, whether leaseland farming will occur. It determines what stipulations will be included in the leases. And I think that that's just worlds apart from trustees for Alaska versus Watt, which we agree, the 1981 district case. I mean, in that case, what the service found was a transfer of the secretary's authority. Including to do things like issue regulations and statutorily provided reports. And that's just worlds apart from the situation here.
Let me read to you from pages, the bottom of 612 to the top of 613. You don't need, I'll read slowly so you don't need to look it up.
Okay, thank you, Your Honor.
This is describing one of the things that the Bureau does pursuant to this agreement. The Bureau shall conduct all compliance reviews of the lease contract and enforcement of the leasing requirements as they relate to, and then there's a long list, crop rotation, seed certification, water use, drainage, pesticide, rodenticide, herbicide uses, row crop acreages in conformance with the Kukulak, land management practice, and any other terms or conditions stipulated in the lease advertisement or contract. And to go back to the beginning of that, the Bureau shall conduct all compliance reviews of the lease contracts for these terms. That sounds like administration to me.
I guess respectfully, Your Honor, I would just disagree. I mean, I think that sort of thing, whether it's enforcing the lease terms, ensuring that lessees comply with them, collecting rent and things like that. I mean, these things perhaps are not unimportant, but they are not substantive decisions about whether leasing may take place, the rules that apply to it. And I think that that's what the statute is getting at. I mean, the Congress.
Let me read you another one now. I'm now on page 613, as parent three. The Bureau shall conduct salt balance studies on all agricultural lease land in order to prevent drainage or soil problems. Or four, the Bureau shall prepare and compile in lieu of tax data for payments to counties. I mean, that just sounds like administration to me.
Again, I think our position is our position is administer means doing things like issuing rules and regulations and deciding what activities can ultimately take place on these lands, which of course is what this lawsuit is about and what is important. I mean, I think it's important to keep in mind that the Bureau of Reclamation the Bureau of Reclamation has long managed the leasing program in this way. And I think it would be odd to imagine that Congress would have essentially required the service, which this is not the sort of things the service typically does, to perform some of these ministerial activities on its own. I think that's just reading too much into a very rote statutory statement that shall be administered through the service. But again, this is nothing like the Watt case, which involved issuance of regulations. And I think the bottom line is there is no transfer of authority here. The all authority remains with the service.
Okay.
Could you address some of the criticisms that were made that the service completely failed to review certain important studies? Or I think one was the Reisner study in 2013 and other studies in the process of determining the plan.
I mean, I apologize, Your Honor. I'm not sure about the Reisner study in particular. I mean, the service cited a number of other studies on the benefits of grazing to sage grouse and the benefits of grazing to habitat management. And of course, this is all consistent with what the service previously found in 1996. But I don't, I'm not sure what to say about the particular Reisner study.
Whether the pesticide adaptive management process, the information is made public, and if so, how?
Yeah. So the output of the pesticide use proposal committee is made public in the form of these pup books, and those books contain a fair amount of information. You know, the pesticide was approved, that was approved, the land type it was the land type it was approved for, the pests that it's to target, the best management practices that will accompany it. I mean, the service, but to your question that you posed to appellant's counsel, so I mean, it's quite transparent in that regard. And the only thing the service approved through the CCP was a process. So the service can't, I don't see how it would have been possible for the service to address the effects of individual pesticides that might be approved on a pesticide by pesticide basis, as Ms. Parent suggests, when that is, when the service had no way of knowing which particular pesticides would be necessary in particular years and which particular practices would accompany it. I think the service's analysis has to be bounded by the scope of the agency action it actually approved. And the agency action ultimately approved was simply a process.
How about the argument on the other side that the government here didn't consider reducing pesticides as an alternative? What do you have to say in response?
So, I mean, the service did a couple of things there. I mean, it's true that the service did not include did not include a no or reduce pesticide proposal in any of its alternatives. I mean, first of all, I mean, as CBD said in their brief, and I think Ms. Parent acknowledged as well here today, they aren't actually contending that they aren't actually advocating an elimination of pesticides. And so I think for mid-range alternatives like this, it's governed by a rule of reason, but the service did a couple of things. First of all, it explained that because of the importance of food for waterfowl, agriculture was necessary for all of the alternatives. And
can I interrupt you right there on that?
Certainly.
If we're talking about the interaction between pesticide and food for waterfowl, we know from the record that the high incident of pesticide is on the row crops, onions and potatoes. And we also know that's not what the wildfowl eat. So if we're talking about preserving food for the waterfowl, that's not the same thing as saying, well, we need the pesticides. Because, for example, if we were to reduce the amount of land used for the row crops, that would automatically then reduce the amount of land, the amount of pesticide that's being used. And it would have no adverse effect whatsoever on feeding the waterfowl. In fact, it might increase the food available for waterfowl because you're probably not going to have row crops, so you're now going to have grain. So I don't see that the pesticide point fits well into your argument about feeding waterfowl.
So, I mean, on row crops particular, Your Honor, I mean, it's correct that waterfowl don't directly eat row crops, but the service explained.
And is it also correct that the highest pesticide use is on the row crops?
I think that's
in the record.
Yeah, I believe that's correct as a general matter. But I mean, the service concluded that it would not ban the use of crops, which the Kekal Act expressly contemplates. But the service explained that it would not ban row crops because although waterfowl did not directly use them, it was an important means of soil health. And I think it's important these issues all sort of blend together. The service also concluded that the effects of pesticide use would be minor based on voluminous data. So that data, as we said, took several forms. It took, first of all, the historical data collected as part of the 1998 IPM process, the 2007 biological opinion that we cited in our brief, and the more recent monitoring data. So given the importance of row crops, both under the Kekal Act, where it's expressly mentioned in the economics of farming, the service's determination that row crops performed it, were an important means of providing for soil health.
I'm not here pushing to say that the service made a mistake in keeping the amount of row crops. What I'm asking about is back to the point raised by me earlier and now just by Judge Bress. I'm not sure why any of that excuses the service from investigating the alternative of cutting down on pesticide use. They could investigate it and say, well, we're going to keep it exactly as it is, but they didn't even investigate.
Well, I'm sorry, Your Honor. I thought you were asking about row crops, and my point was just
that. Well, I was, and the reason I was, because you were telling me that the pesticide use is important because we need to have food for wildfowl. And I said, well, yes, we do need to have food for the wildfowl, but the pesticide use correlates inversely. You're using the pesticides most heavily on the foods that the wildfowl are not eating. That's why I said that.
Yes, Your Honor. I mean, I think the service did consider comments suggesting that first of all, row crops are generally not used on lower Klamath due to soil conditions. This is in the 1998 IPM. But my point is that the service explained why it would not ban row crops, because in addition to being an important means of providing farmers with yield on their crops, that they're an important means of soil health. And I think that, in concert with the service's reasoned conclusion that pesticide use as bounded through the PUP program was reasonable.
Why isn't the reduction in pesticides already part of the plan in the form of the process that was adopted? The process allows for consideration of pesticides and the use or non-use of them based on this whole process specific to individual pesticide use. Why wouldn't we say that this alternative option is already available to the government?
I completely agree with that, Judge Bress. And I guess that the only thing I would add to that is it's made very, very clear in the IPM in multiple places that we cite in our brief is that pesticides, it's not only neutral on the quantity of pesticides, but the pesticides are a tool of last resort. They're only going to be used when other pest management tools are unavailable or inefficient in controlling crop pests. And I think that is also an important feature of the program. I'm happy to. I just regard turning to TID's challenge briefly. I want to make sure I address every issue, but I know that I don't want to try the court's patience because I know I'm already 8 minutes over on my time. I mean, I think for the reasons articulated by Judge Bress, but by all three judges, I think that the interpretation is not only, it's just inconsistent with Section 4, and it would write consistent with proper waterfowl management out of the statute.
I think you're pushing on an open door on that one. Could I come back to the grazing? I've got the same question about grazing. The service did not consider the alternative of reducing grazing. Why shouldn't they have considered that alternative? They could have rejected it, but why didn't they consider it?
Because, Your Honor, I think the main reason that a reduced grazing alternative was not included for detailed study is because the service's authorization of grazing both now and in 1996 was based on its view that grazing provides benefit to the habitat. And the service explained in response to WWP's comments in particular why the other methods, whether it's herbicides, which the service said wouldn't provide the same benefits, or mowing, which is impractical on Clear Lake because of the terrain, was not a viable alternative. So, I mean, I think the reason why all of the alternatives include grazing is because of the service's conclusion. We're all striving for the same thing here. This is just simply a technical disagreement, and the service concluded that grazing was really essential to combat these invading grasses and provide more native grasses. I mean, I just want to address the Abbey case in particular, since WWP says we don't respond to it. I mean, I don't think Abbey stands for this global proposition that a reduced grazing alternative, it's not a grazing specific gloss on the rule of reason. I mean, Abbey arose in sort of a unique context. It was a two-tiered plan in which the service initially concluded in a programmatic determination, not the service, excuse me, I think it was BLM, initially concluded in a programmatic determination that it would not analyze leasing because the scope of the project it was approving was an implementation of a presidential proclamation, which it reasonably read as authorizing grazing. And so then when it got to the site-specific analysis, the court said that since it didn't consider the effects of grazing at all, of course it had to consider at that point a reduced grazing alternative. This case is not like that. The service did not authorize grazing because it erroneously thought it was required by law or for some other arbitrary reason, but like that. The service considered both in 1996 and today that grazing was a beneficial use that provided benefits. So requiring it to replicate essentially the same analysis in the form of considering a reduction in grazing that's simply not the scenario addressed by Abby. And, you know, I would invite the court, you know, as for the specific concerns addressed by WWP, I mean, the service responded in comments and explained why grazing, carefully controlled as it is, was an important management tool on the refuges. I welcome any further questions from the court.
Any further questions from the bench for Mr. Burney? Okay. Well, Ms. Fahey, you've asked for 2.5 minutes to respond to the Two Lake Irrigation District. You can respond if you like, but I think you've just won on that point.
Yeah.
So why don't, if you're willing to forego your argument on that one and simply do whatever you want for rebuttal, if you wish to speak as on the defense side on Tule Lake, you may. But I also, it's time for you to do your rebuttal. Let's put 2 minutes on the clock. See what happens.
Thank you, Your Honor. I will heed the signal from the court and not address the interpretive issue any further. And so, on rebuttal, I'd like to focus on two main things. First, with respect to the water issue. Mr. Burney referenced actions that the government is taking now, and I believe he's referring to the 2021 EA that's cited in their brief. I would point the court to where the Supreme Court's recent decision in the Department of Homeland Security versus Regents, where they reaffirmed the fact that a court cannot uphold an agency's decision based on actions or justifications that are provided after the fact. That action, the transfer of water rights from Upper Klamath Refuge or Upper Klamath Lake, is not part of the plan. If you look at Audubon's record, ER page 208, none of the management strategies provided in the plan include transfer of water rights from outside the refuge. And so the agency cannot cure the inadequacy of its programmatic document by referring to later enacted site-specific actions. That's precisely what they're doing here. Additionally, with respect to Ms. Johnson's arguments regarding the irrigation water right, this is detailed in our brief, but I would just like to point out again that leasing is not a prerequisite to water delivery of the 1905 water right. The agency acknowledges that it can use that water right for the walking wetlands program because that is considered to be an agricultural program, although it provides valuable habitat to waterfowl. And that water right is also used for the cooperative farming program, which provides a much higher food benefit to waterfowl. And then I'd like to briefly turn back to Judge Ikuda's questioning about deference to the agency's expert judgment. The issue here is not simply that Audubon disagrees with the decision, it's that there's no rational connection between the definition of proper waterfowl management and the agency's decision to continue 20,000 acres of leasing while wetlands are going dry and bird populations are plummeting. And their failure to do that comparative analysis of how they could have managed the refuge differently if they reduced leasing is really the core of the issue. And I would point the court to Your Honor Judge Fletcher's opinion from 2010 in the Center for Biological Diversity versus Department of Interior, where that failure to do the comparative analysis that's required under NEPA really undercut the substantive analysis that was required in the underlying substantive statute, where the agency was to give full consideration to specific factors. And that same problem is at issue here. And if there are no further questions, Audubon respectfully requests that the court reverse the district court decision and remand with instructions consistent with this court's opinion. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Parent, rebuttal, put 2 minutes on the clock, please.
Thank you, Your Honor. To satisfy the Refuge Act, the agency has to make a compatibility determination. That's a specific decision that is not going to be revisited for at least 15 more years. And in making that determination, the Fish and Wildlife Service relies on its conclusions that there are only minor effects from the use of pesticides. But this court cannot defer to conclusions that are not supported by a factual facts in the record or analysis. And yes, Judge Fletcher, we did ask for the agency. The agency claims it has all of this analysis, that it's done through the process for the last 20 years or so. And when we got the administrative record index, we noticed that none of that analysis from the PUP approval process was contained in the record. And so we had correspondence with Fish and Wildlife Service's attorneys asking them to complete the record with that analysis that they were clearly relying upon for their conclusions in the EIS that the effects are only minor. And the agency refused to include it in the record.
Did you make a FOIA request for them and were denied?
Your Honor, there had been prior FOIA requests for related documents, but by the time we got the administrative record, we were not, it would have been too late.
Okay, so you did not make a FOIA request.
We did have FOIA requests for earlier information concerning pesticides. None of those FOIA requests, and this was prior to the record of decision coming out. None of those FOIA requests contained the analysis that the agency claims it does through the PUP process. Instead, and honestly, without it being in the record, it's fundamental principle of administrative law that the court's judicial review here has to have some sort of backing for these conclusions that effects are only minor. I want to respond to the idea that the PUP process, the PUP process is not the problem. The problem is that the effects analysis, if it's done in secret and the agency refuses to put it into the record, there's no other place where those effects of specific pesticides are going to be looked at. Moreover, the idea that the PUP process is neutral as to the use of pesticides, there's simply no evidence in the record that the implementation of the 1998 Integrated Pest Management Plan has resulted in reduced use of pesticides on the refuges. In fact, following our signature block, we included a trend line that shows that use is actually increasing on the refuges. And we don't know, but speculate that some of that increase in use of pesticides may be attributed to the fact that the row crops of potatoes and onions have also increased significantly in acreage since the 1960s. And so there's just no evidence that we should trust the government that whatever it does through this PUP process, it's going to have minor effects on the wildlife that's dependent on these refuges for their conservation. Thank you, Your Honors.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Purcell.
Thank you, Your Honor. Just a couple quick points. Mr. Burney references a 1996 determination by the service that grazing is beneficial. And, you know, that determination was not offered as a reason for eliminating reduced grazing alternatives in the EIS itself. It's a post hoc rationalization. And furthermore, you know, it would be wrong to rely on that because that would not take into account new science or new on the ground facts. And one of the overarching purposes of the CCP is to evaluate existing and proposed uses for compatibility with refuge purposes. So it would make no sense to rely on a 1996 determination when this process itself is supposed to take a close look at existing and proposed uses. Furthermore, I want to also mention that all of the tasks that Mr. Burney mentioned that grazing is used for, those again are, you know, post hoc rationalizations, and our briefing lays out how all those tasks can be achieved without grazing or reduced grazing. And one final point, Judge Ikuda, you asked again about the Reisner study. The service can't point to where it considered the Reisner study in this record, and it's directly relevant to this inquiry of whether grazing should expand or continue at all. And to be clear, Western Watersheds Project is not asking the court to determine, you know, which science is correct. But it is the court's role to look, take a close look to see if the agency actually considered relevant science that it had before it. And with this Reisner study, that did not occur. And I have nothing further unless there are questions.
Okay, I think that completes all the arguments. I'm sorry, you've got rebuttal.
Yes, Your Honor.
I apologize. I do not
wish. I know it's late.
No, I'm not hurrying. I just forgot. Okay,
please. I'll be quick again, Ms. Johnson.
No, put 2 minutes on the clock and we'll see what happens. You get to say what you need to say.
A few quick points to Ms. Fay's statement that leasing is not a prerequisite for the water right. Leasing is that agriculture is, and to the extent wetland rotation is allowed under the water right, it's only as a function of how it's useful for agriculture. If you do not have agricultural irrigation, that water will go to more senior uses and most likely ESA uses. To Judge Fletcher's questions about row crops and pesticide use for row crops, crop rotation is actually a part of pest management in agriculture. If you eliminated onions and potatoes and you just grew grains on the refuges, resistance to pesticides would build up over time, and then you'd actually have to use more pesticides. And the service explained that in the EIS, how, you know, both under the KECO Act, which allows for row crops up to 25% of the acres, but just under normal agricultural pest management, the rotation of onions and potatoes with grains actually reduces pesticide usage by reducing the resistance to pesticides. Another point about the cooperative lands, the 1956 TID contract actually limits the acreage that the service can devote to cooperative lands. So that's where the 2,500 acres comes from. And that's directly in the 1956 contract that was approved by Congress. And then a quick point about the administration issue and Audubon's appeal. Different federal agencies have to coordinate over public lands. Here you have a reclamation project. So it makes perfect sense for the Bureau of Reclamation to do things like bidding and collecting rent as part of the reclamation fund. The same type of coordination has to occur with the Forest Service, BLM. I mean, if you were to hold that and minister, it would preclude that day-to-day management. I think you'd have a lot more problems over the types of cooperative agreements that exist between federal agencies with respect to public land management. And my last point, Judge Bress referred to a codependency. The agricultural lease lands and the refuges have coexisted for over a century, and that relationship started back when the project was first authorized in 1905 and when the land was first ceded to the United States. And it continued when the refuges were created and they were made subject to the reclamation purpose and the executive orders. And then it continued into the KECO Act. And for decades, when the agricultural acreages peaked, the bird numbers peaked. They thrived together. It's only in the last decade, when the water supply challenges have become extremely problematic, that this became a manufactured conflict or a false dichotomy between agriculture and the refuges. Since then, the lease hands have been a target for litigation, and this 2017 CCP was no different. So I would urge the court to respect the compromise born in the KECO Act and allow for continued leasing in the refuges. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Now I think we're finished. Thank all of you for good arguments in a complicated case with a lot of issues. The case is now submitted for decision, and we're in adjournment for the day. Thank you.
Court for this session now stands adjourned. Thank you.